Okay. Ayano, I like ya. I love the dark, sassy attitude. I love the harsh, sadistic main character we have right now. I even talked about this in my last episode review. It's so refreshing to have a character that's not an all goody-two-shoes. But at the same time, once again, what I feared and what I talked about in my last episode review is seeming to become true. She's starting to get a little bit too aggressive. Someone that is too savage. Someone that obviously is going down a path of self-destruction. She is literally pushing everyone away that cares about her. Elena is her close childhood friend that cares for her deeply. The whole reason Ayano is even playing badminton right now, again, is thanks to Elena. In some ways, it is Elena's fault that Ayano has turned into this. But even then, though, Elena was just looking out for her friend, wanting her friend to be happy. Because obviously, in the past, her friend was enjoying playing badminton, and she doesn't want to see her friend just being lonely, isolated. She wants her friend to be happy. Which, you know, I'm not faulting Elena at all. Even though she's technically the one that created Ayano to be like this, it's not her fault. She did not see her friend becoming something like this. So, yeah, Ayano right now, she is pushing everyone away. She is pushing away Elena. She is making herself stand out amongst her fellow teammates, and she's seeming very harsh. I mean, what she was saying about Aragaki in this episode was just downright messed up. Now, don't get me wrong. I mean, what Ayano was saying in some ways makes sense. In her own sadistic, harsh, savage way, she was kind of speaking the truth. Because, I mean, Aragaki, she's at the point in her career to where if she doesn't stop, it will end her from ever playing badminton ever again, or any athletic sport at all. So, I mean, what was being said by Ayano was harsh, but it was some truth to it. And, I mean, I guess in some ways people don't like blunt people, or sometimes you can be too blunt because people don't want to hear it, and I guess she is a little bit too blunt, but she can obviously still go about it in a different way. But even then, she wasn't really saying that about Aragaki because of her health, but she was just saying that because there's just no point. If you're not good or whatever, you can't do it, just stop playing. She obviously doesn't consider the feelings of any individual that she's currently going up against. You know, if you're not strong, if you don't win, well, you don't matter in her eyes. That's pretty much how she feels. Now, she does admit at the end of the episode that Aragaki is a really good player, which shows that she recognizes that you cannot underestimate Aragaki even though she was injured. She was very impressed. But at the same time, though, you can see that she was very upset and a little bit stubborn because she was wrong with her prediction and how she proved herself that she wasn't going to let something like, you know, a knee injury get her down. So Ayano right now at this time, she, like I said, is going down a path of self-destruction, and if she doesn't correct this, like, she can be savage all she wants. I think that's completely fine. But if you don't stop pushing away your friends, then you're going to get to the point where you're even more lonely than you already were. Because she already technically lost her mother, okay? Now, I'm not saying that it's her fault. I mean, what her mother did to her was just downright disgusting. And I will not defend someone that's pretty much a piece of garbage. But at the same time, what she's doing now is pretty identical to the very person that she hates. She is becoming her mother. She is acting like her mother and pushing everybody away to where she will be lonely. She will not have anyone to rely on. And, you know, she can get around with that or get along with that just fine for maybe a couple of years or so, but there's going to come a point in time to where she's going to hit a wall, and she's going to realize when she turns around, nobody's there to pat her on the back and say, don't worry, you'll be fine. You'll get it next time. She won't have none of that because she pushed everybody away. So I feel like if something's not done, if she doesn't get a wake-up call very soon, it's going to get very badly for her. Now, anyways, let's talk about Aragaki, because that's kind of what this episode was about, while also reintroducing this new character, Nozomi. I think that's her, character name. Forgive me if I'm mispronouncing it. But we have a new character that's introduced while, you know, Aragaki getting a little bit of the spotlight and more development for her. And personally, I love it. I love Aragaki. I talked about how I wanted more of her in the previous episodes because after finding out that she's not technically, quote-unquote, the main character, I was a little bit sad about that because I do like her. So getting to see an episode focused entirely on her makes me extremely excited. Now, within this episode, it was very clear what the writer of this series was going for. The writer was trying to show how different Aragaki is from Ayano. Now, let me explain. Ayano as I've already said earlier in this video, she's savage, doesn't care about anyone, doesn't take people's feelings into consideration, says what she wants, and just finishes a match, moves on. She's not looking at any individual in front of her. For instance, okay, let's say I was Ayano, and you were just someone playing badminton, you put a lot of training, talent, or whatever, and I was to not look at you, but I was looking at the person that was next after you, or I was looking at the goal in mind. Basically, looking at the objective, the end, but not looking at the journey in front of me. And that is what Ayano's doing. She's not looking at the people in front of her and just shoving everybody to the side to just move on. And Aragaki was the exact opposite. See, in the episode, when she looks at Nozomi, it's like, you know, I'm looking right at you. You know, I'm looking at you for I can get to the finals, the nationals. It showed how different she was from Ayano. They're the exact opposite. And this episode wanted to prove that. Wanted to prove that there's two different ways to handle it. What Ayano's doing is the bad way, while Aragaki, she's doing it the honorable way, in a way to progress as a person, but also continue to love the support, you know, sport, and move forward and be even better at badminton. So I think that's what the purpose of this episode was, or this part of the series, was to showcase that. Now, let's talk about what the message here going on for Aragaki, though. Aragaki, she's in a point now to where she could potentially give up her career as being an athlete, as I already kind of mentioned. And this type of theme does pop up quite often. There's always a character that, you know, suffers some form of injury and, you know, has to face the consequences. If they don't stop, then obviously they're going to have to either quit or they're not going to be able to, you know, go as hard anymore, and they're going to need to just, you know, settle down and rest for a while to then be able to get back into what they want to do. In this case, Aragaki's at a point in her life to where she needs to make a critical decision. Will she continue to push herself to the point to where her knees will give out and she will be done, or will she take a break, and even though she's not going to like it, it could potentially cost her nationals, but save her career for the future, for she could fight and come back another day? That is the question I built up. And even though this is a cliche, this is something that pops up quite often, it's a good cliche. It's a cliche that honestly needs to be there because it's a realistic theme. It's what happens to people in real life. You know, people push themselves, they either sprain their arm, their leg, they suffer some form of injury, and they have to go through so many issues to be able to get back into the game. I mean, you have, let's say, football players get injury and they're off the field for like an entire year or an entire season, and you know, that honestly is bad for them, but they need it to be able to recover. So I feel like here's the question right now Aragaki's got to make. Does she push herself to become a part of the nationals, to win nationals, or, you know, sit back, give up nationals to be able to do it once again? That's the question. I really wonder where she's going to go and what decision she's going to make, and if the coach will make the decision for her. That is the question. Now, let's talk about the coach for a second, okay? Or the two coaches that were the main spotlight within this episode, alongside of Aragaki and Nozomi. Now, Aragaki's coach, as we've seen, he's a relatively good dude. He wants what's best for the team. He wants what's best for his individual players. He cares about them. He's a really good coach. He definitely knows what he's doing, and I don't think anybody can take that away from him. Now, if we go to the other side, you know, the person that Aragaki was going up against, that coach, his looks department is obviously the exact opposite. That's what the writer was going for as well, that they were exact opposite in terms of looks. One's a pretty boy, one's a creepy, grotesque-looking man. Now, like I said, big differences here. They each have their own different teaching methods. You have one that's more of the passive route and lets, you know, the people he's coaching take their own decision what they want to do, while the one that was working with Nozomi, he was someone that was very aggressive. You have to do something. You gotta do it his way, or he's not gonna like you, or you're not gonna do something right, or you're not going to be able to win. And he was basically backseat, you know, playing. He was backseat driving. And honestly, if I was a player and I had to deal with a coach like that, I would say, I'm done. I couldn't. Now, I know you should listen to your coach. Coaches are very vital. They have a lot of good information. Even though they're not playing, they typically know what they're talking about. They have a lot of knowledge on it. I'm not going to say I'm putting the man down for that, or anyone. But even then, though, the point is that, yes, you know what's best in some ways, but at the same time, people need to play for what they want to do, or how they need to play for what they believe in, or they need to play for their own enjoyment, what they want. Because if they're playing for what you want, then they're not going to enjoy it. They're not going to put their whole heart into something. So it's kind of like forcing someone to do something they're obviously not going to care too much about it, unless it's something they're passionate about. For instance, how I feel about anime and manga. So yeah, that was the point going on there with the coach, and he learned a valuable lesson that if he wants to better himself as a coach, but also to overlook new people that wants to, you know, do the sport a bad mitten, he needs to kind of lay off a little bit and understand that people have their own passions or ways to play things that he might not even understand. So yeah, episode overall of Hanebado, great episode, looking forward to seeing what happens next. Be honest in the comments below how you felt about this episode. Did you enjoy it? Did you hate it? Be honest in the comments below. If you enjoy my content, you know, please subscribe. If you like this video, please leave a like. And if you want to get notified for whenever I upload a video, please click the bell icon down below, because for some reason, even if you click the subscribe button, you don't always get notified. So if you want to get notified, click that bell icon. And with that, Chibi out.